You stay with me. We are also joined by Chandan Mitra, former member of parliament and senior journalist. Sir, your first take on the victory of Bharatiya Janata Party in Karnataka?
No, I think it is the scale of the victory is greater than what was expected internally as well as externally. I don't think anybody did an accurate prediction in that sense. And it just shows that the Modi era in India has now really consolidated itself to 21st state, which BJP has managed to win. And I think it's come to stay. So there's no further question about who's the winner of 2019. And we are easily looking towards a Modi era continuing for at least another 5 years, if not more.
Though it's not relevant to the Karnataka election, are you saying that despite the Phulpur and Gorakhpur result where a tie between Samajwadi Party and BSP took place, that consolidation, saturated consolidation can take place in 2019 in Uttar Pradesh, Bihar and Jharkhand?
Well, look, let's see if there's this unity between Samajwadi and BSP and whether it actually works in the ground. It did work in UP for the two by-elections. But a national election or even a state election is a different kettle of fish. So we have to wait to see if the opposition kind of gets its act together. That's first. Second, I think even if it does, we have seen in the past that when you have a strong, powerful personality on the other side, who's very popular, like Mr. Modi, even a united opposition is often unable to put up a serious challenge. So I expect, with or without united opposition, Mr. Modi is here to stay.
Balki?
Mohammed Khan is back with us, I'm told. Mr. Khan, a lot of advice coming for your party president and how Rahul Gandhi just doesn't match up.
Well, Balki, I'm not back. I actually never left. I had the privilege of being able to hear everyone, but did not have the, couldn't seem to get through to you. So I will take this opportunity to first address some of the points a couple of your panelists made, though I may be a little late in the game. One of the panelists said that Prime Minister Modi went to Bangalore and appealed to the people in their own terms, soothing terms, he spoke to them in, and that's my interpretation. But the people of Bangalore, in fact, people of Karnataka will soon find that Prime Minister Modi's fascination and love affairs with states end shortly after counting day. I think 21 states will stand in line and attest to that. The second thing, the Gauri Lankesh example is very, very telling. We are going back and retrospectively writing a narrative that, oh my God, the state government failed. Sir, there's a bigger issue here. We are living in a country where the murder of a woman is carried out by people belonging to a particular school of thought. And it is lauded by a man, in the most vulgar terms, who it turns out is followed by our Prime Minister. My point is, we are living in a society where such culture is generalized and made acceptable by those at the highest level. Politicians, leaders, by definition, should help people aspire to better versions of themselves, not set lower and lower standards. Number three, introspection. Everybody is talking about the Congress should introspect. Sir, somebody said that look at how well the BJP recruits young people, etc. Sir, I am damn proud. Please forgive my language. I am very proud to be a member of the Congress. Every single day, largely because of the values we profess. When somebody carried out an I hate Modi campaign on social media, our leader Rahulji was the first to address it and say that is not our way. Whenever one of our people is not using strong language, we take the strongest action against them. Give show me one comparable example in the BJP. Sir, we may not be winning elections to your taste, but the fact is, we are a party that lives and abides by the constitution. And sooner or later, when this charisma has died away, when the people have realized that the words can only get you so far,
Mohammed,
then they will realize that leadership means much more. And introspection, Kartike, aakhir mein main yehi kahunga. Haan, bole Kartike, bole.
Mohammed, you see, yes. See, if the results are they are almost out there. BJP has gained 61 rural seats in Karnataka, retained 15. The total is 75. I'm just going by data, huh? Congress had 52 rural seats. It has lost almost 30 seats. Okay, JDS has been able to gain 20 seats in rural areas. Congress was supposed to be the party of rural areas. That was the general impression, that Congress gets vote from rural areas. In this surge, not only BJP has done well in urban areas, it still leads in Bengaluru, but it has done very well in the rural areas, Mohammed. And across Bombay, Karnataka, Hyderabad, Karnataka, Central Karnataka and Coastal Karnataka, all four parts, the southern part is with JDS. They have swept there.
Understood and appreciated, but I will tell you again that our vote share remains unchanged. In fact, in some of these rural areas, I was also examining the data, we have gone up in terms of our holding. Prime Minister Modi is able to pull off some very incredible political arithmetic, but again, I am telling you, the Congress ran a good campaign. The only thing we need to introspect about is to make sure that we mark these people better and we are more open to the negative campaigns these guys run and how to counter those. And I think, of course, every election is a learning experience. I wouldn't be so dismayed. Kya Bhagavad Gita mein likha hai na ki haar mein nirasha nahi, jeet mein ghamand nahi. The BJP forgets the latter, of course. But the truth is, the Congress will, as it has from every single election over the last 2 years, will emerge stronger. Of that, let there be no doubt to the BJP and to the RSS.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Mohammed, for being with us, for joining us on our show. Palki, the bottom line is that, you know, the Congress is in Puducherry, Congress is in Punjab, and Congress is in Mizoram. That's the bottom line for the Congress party.
And full marks for optimism from from Mohammed Islam. We're looking at something called the success meter. How has Prime Minister Modi and his campaign fared over the past few years? 21 rallies versus Rahul Gandhi's 41 rallies. And who has been more effective? Amit Shah, of course, has conducted many more rallies. The number of seats they've campaigned in, the Prime Minister went to 169, Rahul Gandhi covered 109. The results are for everyone to see. The seats won, 96 of the seats that the Prime Minister campaigned in for Rahul Gandhi, it was 34. So this is how effective their campaigning has been in the state of Karnataka. The success rate for Prime Minister Modi, 56.8%, for Rahul Gandhi, 31%. So a long way to go for the Congress president, who said during this campaign that he's ready to be the Prime Minister of India if given a chance, also saying that his mother is more Indian than a lot of other people he knows. The Congress's campaign clearly has not impressed the people of Karnataka, with the BJP inching closer to 111 seats. That's what the latest trends say. 109 seats, as you see on your screens. The Congress leading on 71 seats, and the JDS maintaining that 40 figure. Karthike?
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. In fact, you know, some very varied data is coming. You know, there's an article which I was looking through. It says that this election in Karnataka was fought on WhatsApp and not on Facebook. And, you know, these are the articles which tell you the way our democracy, the way elections are fought, have changed in past 4 to 5 years. And this assessment which says that this Karnataka election primarily fought on WhatsApp.
20,000 WhatsApp groups.
20,000 WhatsApp groups. And I saw this in Gujarat also, where the city head of whether BJP or Congress would run 400 to 500 WhatsApp group so that every worker could be coordinated. You know, before we close this part of the show, I would like to take a closing comment from everyone. Prakash, you.
You know, Palki asked a question just before saying, you know, what is the advice you would give to Rahul Gandhi? I would say that the Congress is genuinely a national party with a presence, with a significant presence everywhere, every corner of India. But it is facing a crisis, and maybe this is not the best time for the Congress to say, I will be Prime Minister. Okay? Maybe what it should do is...
Leader of opposition.
No, maybe you should be a rallying point to get the opposition together, find a suitable leader from other parties, project that leader under a new UPA maybe, and look to serve there rather than always get
or
someone to serve you.
Boy.
A new suitable boy would be good, I think.
Sir?
Well, you know, the problem today is the Congress party has virtually ceased to exist as a cohesive political organization and leave alone kind of powerful electoral machine. If there is any challenge that is to be mounted to Mr. Modi and the BJP, I think the entire range of opposition parties have to come together, not necessarily led by the Congress, because others who are more successful at a regional level will obviously be claimants. So it could be a Samajwadi, it could be Mamata Banerjee, it could be Chandrababu Naidu. Some of the strong, powerful local leaders, they can offer themselves as a rallying point. This KCR in Telangana. And I think that's the effort that is going on at the moment. It could still be a Congress Mukt Vipaksh. So Congress Mukt Bharat and a Congress Mukt Vipaksh, and the remaining parties, the regional parties, will probably come together to mount a challenge to BJP.
And what makes Modi invincible at this point of time? No one is invincible forever at this point of time.
One is his hard work. Second is the mistakes committed by Congress. I'll just answer the Palki's question also in this. You know, two statements which Rahul Gandhi made, that my mother is more Indian than many other Indians and I'm ready to be Prime Minister. This smacks of the highest level of arrogance and patronizing attitude. You are not God's gift to this country. So stop projecting yourself as that. Don't be so full of yourself. Come down to the level and go to the streets, learn the organizational skills and have a basically, you know, have an electoral battle like an equal. You are no Raja or Maharaja anymore. So that's the problem basically, which is making, because Modi is connecting with masses as a common man. And here you have an opposition leader whose party has been reduced to, you know, PPM.
But that would be,
and I think still saying that I'm ready one to be doesn't stop overstating his humble origins or so-called humble origins. No,
I'm saying, just imagine that he's saying that I am ready to be Prime Minister. I think this is a very strange kind of statement coming said, from a man whose party is in shambles.
I'll be the devil's advocate here. I'll be the devil's advocate here. If he would have said that I am not ready to be the Prime Minister and let party decide, people would have said that he is a reticent politician.
No, he could have said that let people decide.
The argument cuts both ways.
Damned if he does and damned if he does.
Argument cuts both ways. If he would have said what I'm telling you, then people would have said he doesn't take his profession seriously.
He said that it's not important for me to whether I become the Prime Minister or not, but it's important for me to get this government out because it's not a government that I think is serving the people of India and the constitutional values and the principles of the country compromise. You can always sidestep instead of saying that, listen, here I am. You know, because a lot of BJP's campaign is also borrowed thinking.